in the amendments which they have added is the point. Here I have got the existing law has got setting up and operating the cold chain facility, setting up and operating the warehousing facility, storage of agricultural produce, laying and operating cross-country natural crude or petroleum oil pipeline network for distribution, including storage facilities, being an integral part of such network, building and operating anywhere in India a new hotel of a 2-star or above category, building and operating anywhere in India a new hospital with at least 100 beds for patients, developing and building a housing project under the scheme for slum redevelopment rehabilitation, developing and building a housing project under the scheme for affordable housing framed by the government, and production of fertilizer in India. A very beautiful list. How do I remember, sir, is the issue. Our country is basically agricultural based country. It requires fertilizers. Government has to produce the fertilizer and supply to the agriculturalists. Now I am inviting you to start a company which produces the fertilizer, so that capital expenditure which you are incurring, we will allow 100% deduction so that you can have a lesser tax burden. Second is, today so many political leaders coming with big housing projects, that is slum development and rehabilitation ke liye housing projects, giving a shelter to all is whose responsibility? Government responsibility. We are asking the private entrepreneur to start the housing projects for those in the as a part of slum development and rehabilitation. And our country is now in a great requirement for hospitals. So we are asking you to start hospital with at least 100 bedded facility. So many medical colleges are coming. Every medical college is supposed to have a hospital attached. Building and operating anywhere in India a hotel 2-star and above category. Now people stopped eating in the house. Everybody has got money. So you please come to this particular line of business, 100% of the capital expenditure will be allowed as a deduction. And then cross country natural gas, crude petroleum and a cold chain facility, because so much of the tomato and the agricultural produce go waste unless some storage facilities are there. So you start cold chain, cold storage, we will give 100% of the capital expenditure. Somehow you have to remember that. Now the extended list is what? The extended list is, we are enhancing it to the other businesses which we are encouraging through this particular amendment is setting up and operating an inland container depot or a container freight station as approved as per the Customs Act. Shipyards are to be developed, all those things, PPP, public-private partnership. Please, that is one aspect. Here we are straight away asking them only to start that. Then beekeeping and production of honey and bee wax. Telugu mein kya bolte? Tene tigalu. Bee wax. Then setting up and operating a warehousing facility for storage of sugar, fertilizer, sugar. So these are the three things: container depots, beekeeping and production of honey and bees wax, and warehousing facility for storage of sugar. Into this kind of the businesses, if you start, then 100% of the capital expenditure will be allowed as a deduction. Now what they said is, we are trying to enhance this particular deduction to 150%. When we said 100%, many takers are not there. Then the finance minister thought it fit, let us put one more biscuit. That is, you enhance this particular deduction from 100% to 150% for the expenditure that they are incurring on or after 1/4/2012. Setting up and operating a cold chain. This 150% deduction is not for all the businesses. Into these businesses. That means government identified that in 35 AD covered businesses, some of the businesses are not coming in a full picture, full blow. So we want to have a full blow for them. So we have said, in case if you are having an undertaking in these areas, we will give 150% of the capital expenditure allowed as a deduction. What are those things? Setting up and operating a cold chain facility. Then setting up and operating a warehousing facility for storage of agricultural produce. Nobody is interested in the agricultural side. Then how the country will have a development? That is what Pranab Dada thought of and said, cold chain facility, operating a warehousing facility for storage of the agricultural produce, building and operating anywhere in India new hospitals, developing and building a housing project under the scheme of affordable housing framed by the government, and production of the fertilizers. Out of the list which we have, five type of businesses are allowed for 150% of the deduction. How to remember it? Again, the point is, one is hospital, another is a fertilizer, and all related to the agricultural sector only, whether you call it as a cold chain facility or you call it as a storage facilities for agricultural produce and then production of the fertilizer, and the other two is hospitals and housing. So basically, as a chartered accountant, you have to understand where the tax incentives are there. We have to advocate our clients. So when serving is being done from the other end, if you stand in this end, what is the benefit of it? So as a consultant, you should make best use of the knowledge of taxation in advocating your clients, not only from the examination point of view. Whenever budget comes, you should be very keen in going through each and every class. Because you will become a good consultant only when you advocate the people of which type of businesses there are good subsidies or tax benefits to the businessman. So these are the things like hotels, hospitals, fertilizer business and cold chain facility and warehousing facilities are eligible for 150% deduction. So this is about all. Your 35 AD is the point. So you have to make a note of a few important points. But those important points I will make you to write down after going through this particular example. Because last time what has happened is 32 I explained. Again, one example when I did, I made you to write twice that particular thing. I will have to do it, but keeping the time frame in the mind, let me go through the example. See, what when I said institute is a mother, it is really a mother. It has developed a module saying that our beloved students cannot understand by reading the amendment. Let us help them by giving an example so that they will understand that particular thing. Being the eldest son of that particular mother, I am helping my younger brothers and sisters. So, brothers and sisters, please go through the example patiently and with a smiling face. Right. Mr. A commenced the operations of a business of setting up a warehousing facility for storage of food grains, sugar and edible oil. I have not seen edible oil anywhere in that particular list. This should come when you sit in the exam hall. Right. Fertilizer is there, sugar is there. Then capital expenditure of 80 lakhs, 60 lakhs and 50 lakhs respectively. On purchase of land and building during the period of January 2012 to March 2012 exclusively for the above business. And capitalized the same in its books of accounts on 1st April 2012. What is the expenditure? 80 lakhs, 60 lakhs, 50 lakhs respectively. For what? For purchasing the land and building. Okay. Then the cost of the land included in the above figure is 50, 40, 30. Why they have given the cost of the land? Because cost of the land is not eligible for deduction under 35 AD. Not even deduction under section 35 AD. Land is a non-depreciable asset. Then only the balance is on building. is what you have to remember. Further, during the previous year 2012 and 2013, it incurred a capital expenditure of 20, 15 and 10 lakhs respectively for the extension, reconstruction of the building purchased and used exclusively for the above business. Compute the income under the head profits and gains from business and profession for the year 2013 and 14 and the loss to be carried forward, assuming that Mr. A has fulfilled all the conditions specified for claiming the deduction under section 35AD and has not claimed the deduction under chapter 6A under the heading deductions in respect of certain incomes. What does it mean, friends? Once you claim 35AD, you are not entitled to have ADIA deductions and all that. And the profits from the business of setting up a warehousing facility before claiming the deduction under 35AD and section 32 for the assessment year 2013 and 14 is 16 lakhs, 14 lakhs and 31 lakhs respectively. Now you are asked to compute. First foremost thing is, my which business is not entitled for 35AD? My edible oil business is not entitled for 35AD. So what is my edible oil business? 31 lakhs before claiming the depreciation and the before claiming the depreciation under section 32. So what is the depreciation? What is the depreciation is, written down value of the asset is 50 lakhs, or the expenditure which I incurred on land and building is 50 lakhs. From that I am reducing the land cost of 30 lakhs and I am adding further expenditure of 10 lakhs. Totally it is how much? 30 lakhs. On that, what is the rate of depreciation on building? 10%. So 3 lakhs, 31 minus 3 is equal to 28 lakhs. Understanding up to this level, there is no problem. Then profits from the specified business, I have got food grain business, I have got sugar business, and these two are entitled for 35AD. Now how I am computing it? Capital expenditure incurred prior to 1/4/2012, that is prior to the commencement of the business and capitalized in the books of accounts, is 30 lakhs, 20 lakhs. And then what is it? How I am getting to 30 lakhs and 20 lakhs? 80 lakhs is the cost of the land and building, and out of that 50 lakhs, out of that 50 lakhs is the cost of the land. So 30 lakhs plus during the year what is incurred is 20 lakhs. 80 minus 50 is 30, 30 plus 20 is how much? 50. And then the other business, I have got the sugar business, 60 lakhs minus 40 lakhs, 20 lakhs. So capital expenditure incurred 20 and 15, if I add it, then totally it is 50 and 35 will come. And the deduction under section 35AD, in case of the fertilizer, I am getting 150% of the deduction. In case of sugar, in case of agricultural produce, food grains, 150% of the capital expenditure, and 100% of the capital expenditure in case of the sugar. Now 150% of the capital expenditure, how come you are getting into 150% as 75 on 50? If you add 150, if you calculate 150%, my expenditure is only 50, but I am eligible for deduction of 150%. 50 into 150% works out to be 75 lakhs, and 35 into 100% works out to be 35 lakhs. Then loss from specified business is 59 lakhs and 21 lakhs. How come 59 lakhs and 21 lakhs is coming? What is the profit, friends? Profit from specified business is 16, weighted deduction is 75, 15 is the 16 is the profit, 75 is the deduction. The difference between 16 and 75 is how much? 59 lakhs. And the difference between 14 and 35 is 21 lakhs. And a noteworthy point is what? If you that is what you are going to study in set off and carry forward provisions. In case if you have a loss from specified business under section 35 on account of 35AD, such a loss is eligible to be set off only against income from the specified business only, is a point to be well remembered. You can't set off the same against the other business income. So don't get too much bothered about, sir, fastly did with that particular problem. You have a chance to rework out that particular problem. But Chakravarti's way of looking at is, student should write the notes. Solutions, you all are masters in understanding the solutions, but you should only master how to present the solution. What are the noteworthy points? How to write the noteworthy points? So all the noteworthy points, please make note, so that that becomes a refer before exam notes. And please remember, question paper is not coming from the sky or heaven. It is coming from your practice manuals, your amendment notes, your material given by the mother institute. Okay, write down. Weighted deduction, weighted deduction, section 35 AD and Raskuni. Weighted deduction, weighted deduction at the rate of 150% of the capital expenditure, of the capital expenditure is available under section 35 AD, under section 35 AD, for assessment year 2013 and 14, for the assessment year of 2013 and 14, in respect of the specified business, in respect of the specified business, of setting up and operating warehousing facility for storage of food grains, then friends, next point, deduction of 100% of the capital expenditure, deduction of 100% of the capital expenditure is available under section 35 AD for assessment year 2013 and 14 in respect of specified business, in respect of a specified business of operating a warehousing facility for storage of sugar, for warehousing facility for storage of sugar, where operations are commenced, where operations are commenced on or after 1/4/2012, and noteworthy points like loss from a specified business, loss from a specified business can only be set off, can only be set off against another specified business, can only be set off against another specified business. Dosto, to remember what are the amendments which are brought in 35 AD, let me tell you, three new businesses are being introduced. And in respect of five business, specified businesses, it is not 100% deduction, it is 150% deduction. Make note, new businesses included, new businesses included. I am not making you write total, just a side heading like that. New businesses included. Inland container depot / inland container depot / container freight station. Beekeeping and production of honey. Warehousing facility for sugar. Now, 150% weighted deduction for the following business. 150% weighted deduction is applicable. 150% of the weighted deduction is applicable for expenditure, for capital expenditure, for the following business, for the following specified business. Only those five you write. Cold chain facility, warehousing for agricultural produce, warehousing for agricultural produce, 100 bedded hospital, housing project, then production of fertilizer. Then friends, we have to go through on a revision basis two more provisions, 35CCC and 35CCD. I think earlier you have not written, so write down section 35CCC. What is section 35CCC? 150% of capital expenditure is allowed. 150% of the capital expenditure is allowed on agricultural extension project. Similarly, 35CCD, 150% of capital expenditure on skill development projects. Then, of course, friends, we have a question here. Through question, we are trying to understand the provisions. Look at ISAC Limited is a company. Again, I am saying this is the one which is picked up from your amendments issued by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. ISAC Limited is a company engaged in the business of biotechnology. The net profit of the company for the financial year ended on 31/3/2013 is 15,25,890 after debiting the following amounts. I think all of you are well aware, of course, if you are in the final stage, that there will be a computation of total income. And each head, again, if it is a profits and gains from business and profession, you have to take the net profit and add all the things which are disallowed and reduce all the things which are allowed on a weighted basis. So look at ISAC Limited is a company engaged in the business of biotechnology. The net profit of the company is 15,25,890. While reading itself, the idea should come. Purchase price of the raw material used for the purpose of in-house research development, 1,80,000. Right? So, in-house research ke liye, yadi kuch expenditure incur kare to, what is the deduction? Is what you have to get into your mind. Then, purchase price of the asset used for in-house research and development wrongly debited to the profit and loss account, land 5 lakhs, building 3 lakhs. Thing that should go into your mind is, land is not eligible. Then, expenditure incurred on notified agricultural extension project, just now we studied, definitely we will remember 150%. Then expenditure on notified skill development project, purchase of the land 2 lakhs, expenditure on training of skill development, land anyhow is not eligible. Then the remaining expenditure, that too also weighted reduction. Then expenditure incurred on advertisement in the souvenir published in the political party, this is not something amendment, age old established fact is you can't donate the money to the political party and claim the expenditure. What you can do is donate it, debit it to the P&L, add it back and claim the deduction. There is a beautiful deduction for contributions made to the political parties. Otherwise, political parties, from where they get the money unless you give? Chalo. Compute the income under the head profits and gains from business and profession. See, when everything is there before us, it appears to be very simple. But how to remember is the point again. That's where you are jotting out the points. See, net profit as per P&L account 15,25,890. Those who are preparing for IPCC, first time when they are looking at, please concentrate on the presentation. Other way around, marks will not come. Even you write correct answer. Whenever you do the computation problems, two columns, one inner column, one outer column. Yadi, if you don't follow this pro forma, I am not saying it's mandatory, but indirectly it's mandatory. We know that you have not gone through your material. Then we will ask you to please read your material and come once more. Right? Never we prevent anybody from their rightful right of education. Presentation is most important. So, profit, net profit as per P&L account 15,25,890. You have to add back the one which are disallowed. You have to deduct what is being allowed. Items debited to the profit and loss account but to be disallowed. Purchase price of the land used in the in-house research development being a capital expenditure and not allowed as a deduction under section 35, 5 lakhs is to be added back. Purchase price of the building used in in-house research development being a capital expenditure, the deduction under section 35.14 read with section 35.2 is 1,50,000. Is 1,50,000. That I am adding it back. Then friends, I am not adding it. The items which are debited, if it is debited, I will add it back. Purchase price of the building used in in-house research, because I want to claim a weighted deduction kind of thing. But here try to understand, normally you can do one thing, you can add it back and claim a deduction of 200%, or otherwise you don't add it back, remaining 100% you can claim it as a deduction. Presentation wise, try to understand, actually it is entitled for, let us suppose, what is it, in-house research, 200% it is expenditure is allowed for in-house research expenditure. So you can either don't touch it and claim the additional amount of 100% more, or you add it here and claim their 200%. So the solution is prepared without making any addition here. So you have to remember that only remaining 100% will be claimed as a deduction. Expenditure incurred on notified agricultural extension project to be treated separately. That's what, to be treated separately means, here I will add back that 1,50,000 and later on I will claim 2,25,000, because 150% of the expenditure is allowed. Then expenditure incurred on notified skill development, this thing I have to add it back, to be treated separately. Expenditure incurred on advertisement to the political party souvenir, that I will add back. You see separately how it is being done. Purchase price of the raw material used in in-house research and development qualifies for 200% deduction under section 35.2AB. Already you have debited 1,80,000 there. So remaining 100%, because 200% is allowed to be deducted, so that 100% they are putting it here, 1,80,000. There had you added 1,80,000, here you can claim 3,60,000. Then expenditure incurred on notified agricultural project, 150 there you have added, so 150% of 150,000, 225,000, you are adding it here. Similarly, expenditure on training, skill development, there you have added 250,000 rupees. So 150% of the 250,000, 375,000, you are deducting here and computing the profits and gains from business and a profession. So since the solution is very much there before us, there is no problem, but jottle down the points. Jottle down the points. Point number one, purchase price of the land. Purchase price of the land used in in-house research. Used in in-house research and development. And development being a capital expenditure. Being a capital expenditure not allowable under Section 35. Not allowable under Section 35. Already you have written expenditure on what is it? Notified agricultural extension project 150%. I am not troubling you again. And purchase of the land being a capital expenditure not qualify for deduction under Section 35 CCD. Wherever the land is there, that land expenditure will not be allowed because it is a non-depreciable kind of thing. Then expenditure on notified skill development, already you have written, so I am not again making you write. 150% will be allowed. Expenditure on souvenir of the political party under Section 37 2B, it gets a disallowed. But the point to be remembered is under 80 GGB, you can claim the deduction. This one point, please make note. That is, expenditure incurred on advertisement, expenditure incurred on advertisement in souvenir of political party, in souvenir of political party gets disallowed, gets disallowed under Section 37 2B. However, SSE can claim the deduction. However, SSE can claim the deduction under Section 80 GGB. Claim the deduction under Section 80 GGB. Friends, now definitely the issue which I am giving it to you is a definite question in the exam. What is that? Disallowances under Section 40A1A vis-a-vis Section 2011 and 2011A. First, let me tell you generally so that you can understand what is legally. See, it is not a new thing for us who has already studied the profits and gains from business and profession, that there are certain expenditure on which unless we deduct the tax at source, we are not allowed to claim that particular expenditure, right? But in case if you are deducting after the due date for filing the return, then in the next year you are allowed to claim that particular expenditure. This year the expenditure gets disallowed, next year it will be allowed, right? But to mitigate the hardship to the SSEs, because not all are expected to be very literate about the TDS provisions, somebody paid to me the remuneration without deducting the tax at source. Now I filed my income tax return by including that particular income and I have paid the tax and filed my return within the due date. Now the courts also said, poor SSEs who failed to deduct the tax at source, if the payer is a resident SSE, this is only applicable for the resident payments. For non-resident payments, this benefit is not there. If the payment is to a resident and that resident payee already offered this amount of expenditure to you as a income for him and filed his income tax return, then the date when he filed his income tax return, that shall be the date it is assumed that the TDS is being paid. So accordingly, they can claim the deduction without going for a disallowance. So now the law said, okay, when the courts have accepted such kind of view, considering the true problems for the SSEs, because there is a concept called as SSE in default. Once you become SSE in default, the problem is what? The problem is you are exposed to penalties and interest. Interest, I am not bothered. Since I have already made some mistake, I have to pay the interest. But I am more worried about the penalties. So the law said, as long as the payer to whom you made the payment has offered this amount as his income and filed the return, then there is no question of treating you as an SSE in default and you are not liable for the penalty. I am happy. But what I am asked to do? Please go to the most honest person in the world, chartered accountant, and get a certificate to that tune. That is also not a problem. I'll do that. Now, iska ye matlab nahi that I am also given waiver in respect of the interest. I am still liable for a interest. I am being waived off from penalty. So these are the things which we have to, and you should know how to calculate that particular interest. Right? Not only from the examination point of view, these are also relevant things when students go to the articleship and they need to file the income tax returns of the SSEs, they are going for a statutory audits where they have to see the compliance of the law. Without the knowledge you are going there does not make any this thing. Respect comes with the knowledge, not with the qualification. What's it? Please underline. Respect comes with the knowledge. That respect remains forever if that knowledge gets shared. That respect remains forever if that knowledge gets shared. Always be useful to the society. Right? If you are not useful to the society, there is no difference between a rock and you. Who will respect the rock? Right? So, utility is most important thing to get the respect. Some people say that I am not being respected by my juniors. Respect comes, friends, only by your knowledge, not because you are a senior or you are a finalist. So try to gain as much knowledge as possible, right? With the technology's help, now Chakravarti can go to Andaman Nicobar and can deliver the lecture so that a student in Kashmir can also listen. But what is most important is not the technology, it is the knowledge. Chalo, back to the point. 40A1A. Learn with Telugu mein kya bolte kasi. Right? That must be the spirit. I have to. That killing feeling should be there. Otherwise, you can't become a chartered accountant. Right? See, it is not the complexity. We have to understand and get it. What is this provision want to tell us? So there is a disallowance, SSE in default. When you are said to be an SSE in default, in case of non-deduction of the tax, payer will be treated as an SSE in default under section 201(1) in respect of the amount of such non-deduction. So amendment brought by the Finance Act of 2012 is what? Payer who fails to comply with the TDS provisions shall not be deemed as an SSE in default in respect of such tax if resident payee who receives that furnished the return of income under section 139 and offered such income for taxation and paid the requisite taxes, and an accountant, that is chartered accountant, certifies the same. Then if all these conditions are met with, then the date of payment of taxes by the resident SSE shall be deemed to the date on which the return has been furnished by the payer. So this is the relaxation that you have in 40A1A, and you are not going to be treated as a SSE deemed to be in default. So here the point which we are saying is, actually for 201-1A to be invoked, what is the point? The payer is liable to pay the interest on the amount of non or short deduction of the tax from the date on which such tax was deductible to the date on which the payee has discharged his tax obligation directly. So 201-1A says what? Once you failed to, what is it, either deduct or deduct a lesser amount, then you are exposed to an interest under section 201-1A, and that interest is to be calculated for what period? From the date when it is ought to be deducted to the date of actual payment by the payee is the point. Now the point here is, where the payer fails to comply with the TDS provision and he is not an SSE in default. When he is not an SSE in default, if the payee is going to file his return and pay the taxes and offer this income and get a chartered accountant certificate, then what is the amendment here? Where the payer fails to comply with the TDS provisions and is still not considered as an SSE in default, then the interest under section 201-1A shall be payable from the date on which such tax was deductible to the date of furnishing the return of income by such a resident payee. Earlier the interest calculation is only from which period to which period? From the date on which it is ought to be deducted to the date when actual tax liability is being discharged by the payee. But today we are slightly enlarging that particular date. It is not only sufficient that the payee makes a payment of the tax, even he has to file his return of income. What is the date of return of income? Till that date you are supposed to pay the interest is a point. So if you fail to deduct the tax, then you please usko haath pakadke request karo, please kindly file the return at the earliest, so that what will happen, the interest period will come down, because the interest period will run up to the date of filing of the return by the payee is the point. That is the amendment there. So as far as the disallowance is concerned, no deduction of expenditure. 40A1A says what? No deduction of expenditure like interest, commission, brokerage, professional fees is allowable to the payer if tax not deducted as per the law. In case tax is deducted in subsequent previous year, the expenditure shall be allowed in the subsequent previous year. Now what will happen? When the payee will file his return of income? In the next year only, na? In the assessment year only, he is going to, what is it, file his return of income. When it shall be deemed that this SSE has paid that particular tax? When he filed the return of income. So now also the disallowance will happen if you don't deduct the tax at source. But fortunately, in the next subsequent year, if the payee files his return of income, you will be allowed to claim the deduction in respect of that expenditure which is allowed in the previous year on the pretext of non-deduction of the tax. So there what is stated, where an SSE makes these to a resident payee without deduction of the tax and is not deemed as an SSE in default under section 201-1A, then for the purpose of allowing the deduction of such sum, it shall be deemed that the SSE has deducted and paid the tax on such sum on the date the return is filed by the resident payee. See, try to understand friends, any amendment will be brought into the law either to strengthen the court feeling or to completely wash away the court feeling. In case if a court goes against the department and the revenue, then finance minister will bring an amendment to nullify the effect of the court judgment. In this particular finance act, almost about 30 court decided case laws are being nullified and provisions are made to widen the tax base. Here, of course, this amendment is brought because even the courts also said this kind of the benefit you can give it to the SSEs. Several courts have accepted for this. I am not reading through the court decisions, but these made the wisdom to prevail over the, what is it, the finance minister, and he gave such kind of the concession to the SSEs. So all this reading should make you to get into what is the point, the three amendments. One is 201, second is 201 1A, 201 1 201 1A, and 40A2. 201 1 says what? SSE shall not be deemed to be an SSE in default in case if the payee is offering the income, paying the tax, filing the return, getting it certified by a chartered accountant. And 201 1A interest will get run till such time the payee files the return of income. From the date it is ought to be deducted to the date of filing of the return by the payee is the point. And as far as 40A is concerned, it says that it will be allowed as a deduction in the year in which the payee filed the return of income. These three points, kindly jottle down these three points so that I can go through that illustration, right? But Jyotsna says, sir, please go through the illustration, then we will write, right? Because with the 32 her experiences, she has written twice. So let us accept what Jyotsna says and we will go to the illustration, right? Later on, I will make you to write these three points. Again, I am saying, Ma Institute is helping the students in what way? By preparing the amendment notes with the illustrations. See, that is the reason why I always say to my friends, when they say, you are doing a lot of work to remain as a teacher. No. How you are a fortunate student, I am a fortunate teacher. Because once upon a time, teacher has to do all this exercise. Now notes, PowerPoint, everything is available. Only teacher should stand on his prakashna and start making the life. Right? Understanding it. What I am trying to tell you is, like that only, you have to on your laptop and start listening. Only thing is, life is in catching hold of the, for a teacher, he has to catch the good material. Now, even that task is also I don't require. Because if I teach practice manuals and the amendment modules, I am considered as a very good teacher by my beloved students. Right? So, friends, look at the illustration. That is, a company A Limited, whose due date of filing the return is 30th September, pays the following sums without deduction of the TDS. Okay. If you don't deduct the TDS, you shall be considered as a SSE in default. But kya hua? Rupees 2 lakhs to Mr. X, a resident, as a rent. Due date for filing of the return by Mr. X is 31st July. So, my total knowledge now says what? Even if I don't deduct the tax at source, if that landlord is going to pay the tax and file the return, offer this income and get chartered accountant certification, then I will not be considered as SSE who is deemed to be in a default. Only thing is, the expenditure will be get disallowed here and will be allowed in the next year kind of thing. Rupees 5 lakhs to Y Limited, a resident company, has a professional fee. Due date for filing the return of Y Limited is 30th November. Then rupees 10 lakhs to Z Inc., a non-resident company, as a royalty. Due date for filing the return by Z is 30th September. But this concession is not given in respect of the non-compliance with the TDS provisions, in respect of the payments to the non-residents. Please do remember that facility of not treating you as a deemed defaulter is only with respect to the payments to the resident SSEs only. So on the pretext of the third thing, you become SSE deemed to be in default. So the above sums were paid on 1st July 2012 without deduction of TDS. 1st July 2012 falls in which financial year, dosto? 12 and 13 it falls in, for which the assessment year is 13 and 14. So for the previous year 31-3-2013, X, Y Limited and Z Limited have included the above sums in their respective returns of income. Thank you. First condition is met with, that the payee has to offer this as income. What is expenditure for me should be the income for the payee. Right. And the returns have been filed by X, Y Limited and Z on 31st August and 30th November and 30th September. First, I have to see for X, what is the due date for filing the return? 31st July. Magar, uno kya kare? He has filed on 31st August. Troubled me. I continue to be a SSE deemed to be in default, because my payee has not filed the return within the due date. Dekhenge kya kare. Then the next fellow has filed when? 30th November 2013. When he is supposed to do? 30th November 2013. So be happy. And anyhow, for the third fellow, anyhow, this provision will not have any effect. Company A Limited has taken certificate from Chartered Accountant to the above effect. Now the following are the consequences. What are the consequences? Company A Limited shall not be treated as an SSE in default for the payment of 2 lakhs made to Mr. X without deducting the TDS. See, if he files the return under section 139, in 139 you have two things. 139(1) deals with the before due date. Otherwise, belatedly also you can file your income tax return. Only thing is, belatedly if you are doing it, next year you will be, what is it, allowed to claim that particular expenditure. So here when we say return is filed under section 139, it is not only return covered by, what is it, due date return, even the belated return. So Company A Limited shall not be treated as an SSE in default for the payment of 2 lakhs made to Mr. X without deducting the TDS. Company A Limited shall pay the interest at 1% from which date, when he is supposed to deduct the tax, to the date of filing of the return by the payee, when he has filed the return on August, what is it, 31st August 2013. TDS is what, on 2 lakhs, rent 10% is the TDS. So that is comes to 20,000. The expenditure of 2 lakhs shall be allowed to the Company A Limited in the previous year 31-3-2013 as per the provisions of 40A1A. So how come it is 31-3-2013 as per the provisions of section 41-1A? See, when he has paid on 31st August 2013 and our SSE, who is our SSE? He is a, it is a company. And our due date is what? 30th September. So when we discuss about this particular provision, you have to see whose due date is most important. It is whose due date, that is, has furnished the return of income under section 139. So it is only as long as he furnishes his return of income within the due date of the SSE who made the default, that is enough. Anyhow, I will make you to write that notes. Then friends, 10 lakhs rupees, then next is, Company A Limited shall not be treated as an SSE in default for payment of 5 lakhs to Y Limited without deducting the TDS. Company A Limited shall pay the interest at 1% per annum from 1st July to 30th November. Your interest under 201(1A) runs from which date to which date? The date when you ought to deduct the tax to the date when that fellow has filed the return of income. So the expenditure of 5 lakhs shall be allowed to the Company A Limited in the previous year of 31-3-2014. Why 31-3-2014? Because our SSE, actually when the return is filed 30th November 2013, when this particular fellow is also supposed to file his return 30th November. But the defaulter, our SSE company, is supposed to file the return on which date? 30th September. So the other fellow has not filed the his return of income before the due date for us. So he has filed after the due date. So this expenditure which gets disallowed this year will be allowed in the next financial year, next previous year. To this tune, you have to be meticulous when you are preparing for the final examination. Then rupees 10 lakhs to ZA, what happens to that? Look at, company A Limited shall be treated as an SC in default for payment of 10 lakhs to ZA Limited without deducting the TDS. Since payment is made to a non-resident, it shall be liable to pay the penalty and interest for being an SC in default. The expenditure of 10 lakhs shall be disallowed under section 40A1 since TDS has not been deducted by the company A Limited. So that is all about that 40A1-2 and your 201 and 201-1A. Now I will make you to jot down the points. Now write down this particular table so that you get a complete clarity. But before that, let me also make you to write that three important points. Write down those three important points. That is section 201-1, section 201-1, payer who fails to comply, TDS provisions shall not be deemed to be an SSC in default, in respect of such tax if such resident payee, has furnished the return of income under section 139 B, offer such income for taxation. C, paid requisite taxes D, gets a chartered accountant certificate for the same. Next point. The date of payment of taxes shall be deemed to be the date on which return has furnished by the payer. The date of payment of taxes by the resident payee shall be deemed to be the date on which the return has been furnished by the payer. Write down, payer. Not payer, payee. Right. Payee. Next, interest under section 201-1A. Write down, interest under section 201-1A, make it side heading. where the payer fails, where the payer fails to comply with the, to comply with the TDS provisions, and not an SSE in default, and not an SSE in default, under section 2011, under section 2011, the interest under section 2011A, the interest under section 2011A shall be payable, shall be payable from the date on which, from the date on which such a tax was deductible, from the date on which such tax was deductible to the date of furnishing, to the date of furnishing return of income, return of income by the resident payee, by the resident payee. I have got just 2-3 more transactions which I will finish off it in about 15 minutes.